He's recording.
That's right. So, where was I? So, the argumentative support communication system and all of that is critical, because if you see about Megan, who's able to speak out for herself, she is non-ambulatory in a wheelchair, and articulation is difficult for her. Has nothing to do with her cognitive ability. She's a bright young lady. So because of the support system, she's able to access all aspects of life. It's amazing. And also to let you know, Sean Pevsner is a special education lawyer in Dallas, and he has cerebral palsy and is wheelchair bound and doesn't communicate, articulate on his own. So he uses also an augmented device, and he has gone into cases and won because everybody's overwhelmed with his presence, which, okay, that's fine. He wins the case, so that's good. So what it's doing is changing lives. And she's going to share with you how the apps can support and change lives as well. So she's also a consultant for companies. Betsy does a lot of consulting for companies on apps and other things. I'm sure she's going to clarify all this, because I'm just learning about all that she does. She is a speech and language pathologist and autism consultant with 25 years of experience in a variety of settings. So her experience is extensive, and I think you're going to find what you're learning today is going to be useful in everyday life, and it's only going to get better with all the upcoming technology that we have. So, welcome, Betsy.
Thank you, Robin. Get the mic on again. Okay. So as Robin said, I am a speech pathologist. I've been a speech path for 25 years, doing a variety of different things. Normally, I don't mention this, but I am floor time trained, since it actually means something to y'all. And I love floor time. People thought it was really weird when I went almost directly from floor time. I worked at the Bridges program at Texas Children's, almost directly from floor time into using technology with kids. But I make it very engaging, very meaningful, and it's very interactive the way I use technology with kids. So I'm a consultant for Bridging Apps, which is why I'm here today. And right now my main role with Bridging Apps is working with this transition tool, as I told you. So I think Robin handed out the cards. Please do my survey once, twice. Somebody from the state was like, you know, I don't think they really track how many times each person does it. I was like, that's a good idea. It is a struggle to get people to fill out a survey. So the state told me in their huge survey, this is the children with special health care needs, in their huge children with special health care needs survey, they only got 700 back. So I've got like 135, so I'm like feeling, my goal was 1,000, but I might have set that too high. Yes, we have off and on, but I can put it on again so y'all can find it.
I can link it up with TSA social workers as well as NSAW. I'm going to meet you tomorrow with NSAW.
Oh, that would be great. Thank you. We have it. This is the card I gave y'all, is the adult survey. We do have a survey for youth also. Okay. So I'll put both links on social media. And I need to put it on the Texas Mommies for Miracles again, Facebook. So I guess that leads right into the fact that I am also the mom of a child with special needs, why I'm in the Texas Mommies of Miracles. I have a 19-year-old as of 2 days ago. He has a neurometabolic disorder and severe intractable epilepsy, and he's at college living in a dorm with his service dog and doing great. He's been in the hospital a few times this week, but it's amazing what happens when you're not the first responder. It's like, whew, now I have time to do all of this stuff. So he's doing really, really well. He had, before we really knew the extent of his seizures, he actually was showing signs of autism. And it turns out that he was only autistic sometimes. And so I was like, you know, this is really odd, because I work with children with autism and they usually don't like go back and forth between this. So It turns out he has frontal lobe seizures, and so that was causing a lot of symptoms that looked like he had autism. And at one point I did consider doing, well, I did floor time on him, but he was kind of older by the time I started doing that, but I actually did consider putting him in ABA at one time just because of all of that, which obviously would have not worked out well. But anyway, his name's Henry, and like I said, he's 19, he's an Eagle Scout, and he's just doing great. So he's at Southwestern University in Georgetown, Texas, and they're super supportive, great student support there for kids with disabilities. It's not what they specialize in, but they have been really awesome. I also have Sam, and I say God only gives you what you can handle, and that's why he gave me Sam, because Sam is super easy and like no trouble at all. He's my easy child, and that's all I could handle after Henry. And Sam is 13. He's in seventh grade at Westbury Christian School, and he plays baseball, and he's working on his Eagle Scout project, and he's just like totally neurotypical, just easy kid. Not anything remarkable really to say about Sam, except he's super easy, and he's very compassionate to people with disabilities, so I'm really proud of him for that. And I have a husband named Eric, and we live in the Meyerland area. So I was a founding member of Bridging Apps, and I've been with them on and off in some capacity, first as a volunteer, then as a consultant. Then I was actually an employee of theirs for a while, and now I'm back to being a consultant. And I'm gonna tell y'all a little bit about Bridging Apps. I'm gonna kind of go through this quickly so we can get on to talking about the apps. But I'll tell you a little bit about our background. So Bridging Apps was started by Kristen Reet. I'm gonna go to her picture. Was started by Kristen Reet. Her son is Vincent. He has Down syndrome and autism. And I was his speech therapist when the iPad came out. So when the iPad came out, Kristen thought, this is perfect for Vincent. Let's use it in therapy. So I was like, sure. I was using an iPod Touch with my adult patients, with geriatric patients who had had a stroke or Alzheimer's. And so I was like, sure, let's try the iPad with kids. I hadn't had a lot of success with the iPod Touch with kids because they tend to just like go into it, and I could not share the experience with them. So we started using the iPad with Vincent, and it was great. And so she decided we needed a support group. So she got the support group together. So it was parents, educators, and therapists at first all getting together to talk about using iPads with kids with disabilities. And then one day Sammy Raymond came in and he started up a website for us. So Kristen and Sammy are considered the founders of Bridging Apps. Sammy was really the driving force behind our website, which is kind of what we are today. Sorry, I have to go backwards. So since that time, we got the website, we started doing a lot of reviews of apps and having professionals review apps. So every app is reviewed by a professional who has used the app with a child with special needs or an adult with special needs. Because there are a lot of cases where like, I'll look at an app and I think it's great. Then I try it with a kid and they think it's terrible. So we made that a criteria from the beginning to do the reviews. We only review apps that we have actually used with a child. So that's kind of sets our review system apart. We also have a lot of physicians and other professionals involved with us now. We also have dietitians and nurses who are doing reviews for us because we do a lot of medical apps. And since those early days, we quickly moved into also addressing the use of technology and iPads in particular with adults with developmental delays or disabilities, but we have now added seniors. So we do a lot of work with seniors as well. And they don't necessarily consider themselves to have a disability. I mean, we're all losing our vision. Some of us are losing it a lot faster than others, like me. And so we all have, you know, levels of special needs. And so we've really moved into the senior population and the medical world, looking at medical apps. So basically we love the power of technology to improve people's lives in general. And that's Vincent and his brother Martin. Oops, I should get back to that. On our website, you can register on our site for free. We do have app lists, so we review all our apps based on what the need is of the child rather than a label. We do have some app lists, so we have app lists for kids with autism and app lists for kids with Down syndrome. But in our review system, we do it all based on skill, need, rather than a label of a diagnosis. And we do list all the developers' information as well as our own narrative about it. A few of them have videos, but that proved to be really, really time-consuming. We do review apps for Android and iOS, which is iPad and iPhone. Also through Bridging Apps, we do trainings like this. We have three assistive technology labs. We have one in Bel Air, one in the Fort Bend area, and one up in the Woodlands that are staffed once a week, and you call to make an appointment, but anyone in the community can come into the assistive technology labs. We have tablets loaded with apps. Bel Air is the closest to here, yes, but maybe the hardest to get an appointment at.
Okay, the
other? Andy's up in the Woodlands. She's probably the easiest to get connected with. Yeah. Oh, okay.
And so he's very resistant, so I'm trying to connect him with the community, not mother saying, you know, it's a lot quicker if you do this this way, but we're still exploring what his abilities are bottom line, so we don't want to, you know what I'm trying to say? Mm-hmm.
There wouldn't be anybody else there. I mean, there'd be like whoever was manning the lab at the time, so there wouldn't be like other kids, you know?
But that's probably a good thing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You could just touch and feel and play around with it.
Right.
One will pique his interest. Yeah. Might need a little bit more directive through a therapist.
Mm-hmm.
By the institution, like a speaker. I don't know.
It was not long.
Oh, yeah.
Or right,
teacher.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, I think I love using apps with all people of all abilities, and they're just so powerful. So that's what I usually tell kids is and like some of the kids, well, the kids that I work with long term, like I have I always call him a little boy, but he's 20 now, but he was 3 when I started working with him, and now one of my therapists works with him. But like I tell him, I mean, he knows Henry, my son, and he knows Henry has seizures, but he also knows Henry's in college and like, you know, has always participated fully academically. So I'm like, you know, when he gets discouraged, I'm like, this might be hard for you, but who's gonna win if you and Henry play a video game? And he's like, me. We all have our differences. So I always give him examples of, you know, this is a great app for you to use because you have dyslexia. But I know this other kid who is a great reader, but his eyes get really tired, and so he uses this app, you know? So I always try to give them, like, these broad explanations of different people who can use it so they don't feel like this is just for me because I have special needs. We have some local meetings, although our local meetings are now kind of moved to the Apple Store. So it's on our Facebook page, but I think it's the third Wednesday of the month at the Apple Store at Highland Village at 10 a.m. They let us use their special room upstairs. It's like this, there are only like 6 of them in the world or something. And so it's this special high-tech, special Apple room. And the Apple people actually run the group. So there's always someone from Bridging Apps there, but the Apple people run the group. People can go in if they like need a device set up, but sensory-wise, it's too much to be in the store, or if they need like special instruction about something. And then the Apple person who runs it always does like a topic that day. So, you know, it might be on using VoiceOver or, you know, some kind of... I think it's the third Wednesday of the month at 10. I need to put it in my PowerPoint because I never can remember. I always do evaluations on Wednesday, so I hardly ever get to go. But
it's on the website, though, all these
things? It's on the website, yeah. Okay, so on to the fun stuff, the apps. So I love apps. I am addicted to apps. And when Henry started, when I really started transitioning Henry when he was about 2 years old, but when I started full force transitioning, I really started looking at apps for him. Henry does not love technology. He is kind of a kid who likes pencil and paper and real books, and he's like an 80-year-old. So it's been a little bit of a struggle with him. Like, he's not a kid who's fully embraced using an iPad or a phone. But it's still, these apps have still helped him tremendously. So his main issues are medical independence. So I always start with that because that's kind of like what I really have, you know, every day, all day experience with. So the first one is, my handout is out of order of my keynote. Sorry about that. The first one I'm going to show y'all is, I guess I should say, does anyone have a child with seizures? Okay, so I'll show you seizure tracker. I thought, surely there'll be people with epilepsy here. So we use this. This is an out-of-date version of it. I'm like so, and it's going to be funny on the screen. People are so like, oh my goodness, I can't believe you're showing Henry's medical information. I'm like, he doesn't care. He really doesn't. He's fine with it. So anyway, what you do, you can go in and do a quick capture, and it will automatically video the event. So I rarely do this just because I'm weird about seeing his seizures on video, but I have done it occasionally because I just needed the documentation for the doctors or whatever. So it will time the seizure as well as video it. And you can put in, as you can see, you can put in your rescue medication and your VNS, if you have a VNS and you're swiping your VNS. And then you have your events. Oh, good, it's right side up now. You have your event summary. You can go in here and change the length of it, for instance. I never hit that button when he starts seizing, so I always put in, you know, however long I think it might be. You can put in the type of seizure. It does autofill whatever the last type of seizure was, which is convenient. You can put in what his mood was, and then you can put all sorts of different triggers. So these are the ones that are already in here, and then you can also add your own as a trigger. You can do a description. It does autofill what you had last, which is, again, convenient because Henry has a few different types of seizures, but he has one, you know, usually he's having tonic-clonic, and they're pretty much the same. You can put notes in, you can put post-event description, rescue med, and add rescue med and add VNS usage if you do that. So I'm going to delete that. And then, let me see if I can get to my... Then you can do things like find out when the VNS was used, rescue meds. Oh, I didn't know I put a rescue med in here. He has a VNS, so that's what we normally use. And then you can go on to their website. So as you can see, we've been using it for a while, although this version is not updated. You can go onto their website and look at trends. So you can see, 90% of his seizures are now at 7 a.m. in the morning. And, you know, or the rescue meds are never working. So why are we doing that? Or, you know, so you can see they have all these like endless charts and graphs that you can make with your data that shows you all of this information. And it's just really convenient to have. I used to just write it in my calendar or whatever, and this is so much more convenient because I can actually have it all compiled in an organized manner for the doctor. The next, well, actually the most helpful app that we use is called CareSync. And CareSync, the app is free. Oh, and there we go again. Oh, good. The app is free, but there is a paid subscription that we use, but you don't have to use. So we have our whole family in here. So I'm going to show you Scout first. So this is Scout, St. Henry's service dog. And the reason I have Scout in here is because I can put things in like his, this is his, you can see any appointments that he might have. Oops, oh, there were some in there. You can see appointments that he had in the past. You can also go in and see any records that we've put in. And this is his summary. So I'll show you Henry's in a minute because it's a lot more, but this is kind of a summary of Scout's medical stuff. And it has like his veterinarian's number, the vet that the trainer took him to, all of that kind of thing. And you can also put emergency contacts. Also, but the reason I have it in here is because you can put documents in here. We do not pay for the version, for the paid version for Scout, but I'm able to just scan his documents. And so I have his rabies right here, and I can put in any other document. So it's actually the scanned PDF of his rabies shot. So then if we go to a new groomer or whatever, we have it right there with us. Henry has this on his phone as well, so which is really important since he's off at college. He needs that, and he really needs Henry's own stuff too. So this is Henry's. We do not use the medication tracker anymore, which is why he has 200 and something notifications, because we use PillPack, which is the most awesome pharmacy service. They send the medicine already separated into packs. So there's like, for him, he has like two mornings and two evenings because his medicines won't all fit in one pack, but it's so convenient. I started using it over the summer with him to get him ready to go off to college, and then I was like, this has like revolutionized my life not to have to sort medicine. Why didn't I do this before? So anyway, so we don't use the medication tracker anymore on his, but as you can see, this would be his care plan, so this is his medications. If he was going to check them off, oops. You just check them off here. So here are his appointments, and then his timeline takes forever because what we now have is we have pretty much everything. Well, I have from November 2016. It's harder for me to update it now that he's there because I forget. All the way back to his birth, actually. So it probably won't all fill in, but what their paid service does is we pay $200 a year, and they request all of his records for us. When they actually get the records in their offices in Florida, a nurse reviews them, summarizes each record, and then enters it in here. So it's amazing. So things like, I literally have his birth records in here. Oh, we're almost there. January 1999. He was not even a year old yet. So we'll go into one of these old records. So this is the summary that the nurse made. And then down here we have the file. Then we have the actual PDF of that visit. So when I go to a doctor now with him and they're like, do you have that endoscopy from 2004? I'm like, yes, I do. It's right here on my phone. You can fax the records out and email them out from the iPad. So you have them all there. So now that he's in college and he has an extremely complicated medical history, and so he doesn't remember all of it, literally. I mean, he's, you know, and some of it he doesn't think is important because it's him. And until he was like 8, he thought everybody who was sick went to the hospital. He came home from school and he said, so-and-so's sick. I wonder what hospital she's in. And I was like, she just has strep throat. She's not in the hospital. But he's always in the hospital when he's sick. So it's like, you know. Anyway, so he doesn't know his whole medical history. So for him, this is so helpful. And then also, I'll show you his summary. I can never remember where it is when I'm like up here speaking. Health information, there it is. So this is his summary. So it has all of his demographics, all of his allergies, his health conditions. It's still thinking. All of his health conditions, all of his doctors that he's ever seen. And anything I left out, they filled in from the records that they got. So every procedure that he's ever had, his current medications, insurance information. Anyway, all of that stuff that they ask you. Oh, vital signs also. So he can just, when he gets on the ambulance and he is by himself or he's with friends and they ask, what medications are you on? He just can, in his postictal state, pull up CareSync on his phone and hand it to them. So it's this, I love CareSync. So the, like I said, we do a paid version for him. For the rest of our family, we do the free version because you can scan your own records in there and put them in there. But for Henry, it is definitely worth $200 a year to get all these records and have them organized. And you can filter and, you know, I can look by doctor or by keyword searches. It's amazing how wonderful this is. Pillboxy is a medication app that allows you to, I had to load it onto this, it allows you to put all the medications in. It's a medication reminder, but the cool thing about it is you can put in a picture of the actual pill, or you can put in a little representation. Let me see if I can get down. Oh yeah, here we go. So I'll do pink. And then on the schedule, what I love is you take it. So I'm tapping the pill and then I'm gonna drag it into 8 a.m. And then I can also drag it into 8 p.m. And then we can do days and it can do weekly or whatever. I'll put it on Monday and Tuesday. So then you have your visual representation of your medication schedule on here. So it's a great app. It was actually off the market for a while and they didn't want to spend the money to update it. We were actually in the process of trying to buy it from them. And somebody gave him, I think like some other developer like took on allowing him to keep the app, but took on the maintenance of it. So that's Pillboxy. So apps for communication. Does anyone want to see augmentative communication apps? Yes, okay. So I'm going to show ProLoquo to go first. This is the most common, oldest. It's funny to say something's old when it's like 6 years old, but it's the oldest app for the iPad. It is only available for the iPad. I'm doing an online course for augmentative communication and for parents. And so I've been interviewing the founders of these companies that make augmentative communication apps. So I talked to the ProLoquo guy the other day and I was like, are you ever gonna make it for Android and Windows? And he was like, no, probably not. So anyway, but he has a really cool backstory because he was he did something completely out of the field of technology, but loved technology. And one of his friends was hurt, severely injured in a car accident and had a spinal cord injury and is now unable to use his hands. And so he developed a communication, or not a communication, access to the computer. So like a keyboard that was accessible to this guy who had very limited movement. And then because of that, he developed what's called ProLoquo, which is a computer-based augmentative communication solution. And then he developed ProLoquo to Go when the iPad came out. So he has a really cool backstory. So ProLoquo to Go is one of the most common apps. What I hear a lot from people is it's too much. There's too many buttons. So what I usually just like to highlight with it is that you can cut it down to a very simple user interface. And they're actually coming out, their next release, which is coming out in a couple of months, is going to actually have a progressive user. So what's going to happen is you can decide, you can think, okay, I think this person is going to be able to handle 32 buttons on the screen eventually based on their like motor skill and their vision. So we're going to start with that, but we're only going to make one button visible at first. And then you can progressively add the buttons, but it's automatic. Like you just go in and flip the switch. Right now that's what I do, but I manually have to add back in all the vocabulary. So that's going to be really awesome. Because for a lot of people, especially kids with autism, it is too much to see all of that on the screen, but they can totally handle the vocabulary. And they really can handle it from a visual and a cognitive perspective. It's just at first, it's just overwhelming. And I think it's overwhelming for families to see all of that. So I usually cut down ProLoquo to an I want button that opens into ball and water or something, just to get the idea across. We're communicating this and you say it, you're getting it. And then I quickly go into something like this where you have folders. So
I want.
Sorry. Let me turn down my iPad. That might help. Yeah. Well, let me turn down the volume. Okay. Hold your ears.
Music.
Okay. So I'm not going to push the buttons anymore. But you get the idea. So then you go into folders where it's like a couple of vocabulary words in each folder, and then you can quickly build from there. Because when you're at this level, they're only saying what you have anticipated they want to say. So obviously that's not true communication. But you have to start somewhere to get to a point where they're not so overwhelmed. So ProLoquo is highly customizable. You can put in photos. You can put in their included symbols. It can be color-coded if you want. You can change the button size. You can have them farther apart on the screen if that's helpful. Uh-huh.
It's expensive, but often it goes on sale in April.
So if you're thinking about buying it, wait until April because it's usually 50% off in April. Uh-huh. I do, and I have a flyer. It's not a good flyer, but it is a flyer. Yeah, so I'll give it to you when we're done. Yeah. Oh.
One thing I wanted to ask you, Betsy, is this in schools now? Can we request that through an ARD meeting?
Yes.
Augmentative device, or do they just tell you what type you're going to get still?
Well, they try to tell you what type you're going to get, but that's illegal. So you have to push it. I still am baffled by the fact that schools want to push a Tobii Dynavox that's $8,000 rather than spending $500 for ProLoquo and an iPad mini.
Okay, and let me explain to families here who probably don't know this, that whenever you choose to place your child in a non-public setting, the school district in which your non-public school resides is responsible for any assessment. So you can go to Spring Branch and say, I want a communication device. And it's hard. I'm not saying it's easy. But I want a full evaluation on assistive technology for my child that's over at Monarch. And they have to come in and do that. If they don't do it, they have to tell you why they're not doing it, what else they're going to offer you. It's an involved process, but if there are questions, let me know. And then hopefully you can get some, we're trying to do it right now for a student, and hopefully you can get some augmentative device. And,
and then if you disagree with their evaluation, you can request an independent education evaluation. And I am an IEE provider for most of the districts. And they work very nicely with me too. Like once I also think well, you could have saved a lot of money by just buying the iPad and not having me come in and tell you to buy the iPad, but whatever. So, however we have to do it.
Just know, folks, that there's ways to get that stuff from your child.
There's also, in Texas, we have a program called STAP, the Specialized Telecommunications Assistance Program, and it's for telephone access. And so the telephone companies pay into this fund. We actually all pay into this fund. It's one of those little on our telephone bills, you know how they're all those charges. It's one of those. And if you have a speech pathologist who can make a case for why they need an iPad or another device to access the telephone network, STAP will pay for it. I don't have much luck with kids under 6 years of age. I have great luck with high school, with like teenagers and adults. They almost always do it.
So has that program changed? Because it used to be, I know there was easier access in order to get a device and like an iPad. Is it still accessible?
Mm-hmm.
Is that better to get an iPad?
It is. It goes up and down. Like they redid their system, so it was like a year before they could get their system working again, and then they didn't have the right printer or something. I mean, it's a lot of crazy bureaucratic problems, but right now it's actually pretty good. It's been pretty good for the last 6 months or so.
Give me the name of the acronym again.
STAP. It's Specialized Telecommunications Assistance Program. And it's unique to the state of Texas. We have one thing going for us. We have staff. So I'll show you ProLoQuo for text also, because this is a great one for use with maybe people who do speak and are able to read and type, but are not terribly functional with their communication. So what I run into a lot, especially with kids with autism, is that someone has said, well, they can say words, so they don't need augmentative communication. But they may not be saying words, they may not be using their words functionally, so they can't functionally communicate. Yes, they can verbalize, but it's not functional. And for those kind of kids who can read and type, ProLoQuo for text is great. I have like customized this with all the colors, so it does not look like this when you open it up. It's just white background. But you can add in, I'm not gonna make it talk because it's gonna make us all, or me at least, go crazy. You can put in your own phrases, so you can have pre-programmed phrases and sentences. You could actually have a pre-programmed entire paragraph if you wanted to. You can also, on this side, there's the history. So you can go through there and just hit, you know, something that you'd said before to repeat it. It also has word prediction. So as you can see, it already has. The iPad thinks my name is Elizabeth. It is my legal name. So
my name is.
Sorry. You can tell I'm like have sensory issues. So it has word prediction and it has sentence prediction. So it really helps speed up. The other really cool thing about this app is if you have someone who's bilingual, if you have like a Spanish keyboard and English keyboard on your iPad, you can switch ProLoQuo to Spanish by just switching the keyboard. And you can have a separate voice for the Spanish and everything. It's incredible.
And doesn't research support all these augmented devices to increase speech?
Yes. And I have seen that firsthand. In fact, I have two kids that I'm working with right now. They both happen to have dual diagnosis of Down syndrome and autism. I think I have a corner on that market, that Down syndrome, autism, dual diagnosis market. Both of those kids were totally nonverbal, started using ProLoQuo, and they are both, one of them is not using the device at all. The other one is still using the device for some support, but he is just unbelievably quickly developing verbal language. And all the research says that that's what happens. And the research I usually cite is back like in the early 90s, because I want to show people this is not new information. We have known this for a really long time, because it's easier to talk than to use a device like this. you have your mouth with you all the time. You have to have this, you know, it's just one more thing you have to carry. And kids get that. It's not easier for them. But once they learn the power of the communication from using something like this, then they'll start verbalizing a lot more. So sounding board, I'm not going to show because I'm going to end up running out of time, but sounding board is a free augmentative communication app. That's why I always talk about it. It's not a wonderful app, but it's free. It is, you can use it for full communication. It's just you have to build every board yourself. You have to add all the photos in. It has some symbols, but they're very ugly.
Would you suggest just using one, like if you're using Pro, just use Pro?
Yes. Just one, yes, yeah. And for most kids, if they're working with one and they're fairly successful, I would stick with that one instead of wanting to jump, you know, to another. There are people out there who are such great AEC users. For example, Megan, you could put any device in front of her and she would be able to use it. That is usually very confusing for the family and the teachers because then they don't know the device and that scares them. But for most kids, I try to stick with the same one. I have switched quite a few kids from a Dynavox Toby device to ProLoquo because they just were not successful with the Dynavox device and the family hated it and they didn't want to carry it around and there was all this negative baggage about it, and I have switched them successfully to ProLoquo. So you can switch. It's just, you know, and yes, just one at a time, except for this next one I'm going to show you, which is called ScenSpeak, because it is a scene-based communication device. And so what I like ScenSpeak for, and the reason that I say, yes, you can use this in addition to ProLoquo or another AAC app, is that you can, what I love to do, and I don't have one on here right now, and I don't want to push anything and make it talk, you can put a photo, say from your weekend or your summer vacation, on here. You can program hotspots on it. So like on this park one, there are hotspots where you can touch and it's like, it says, I want to swing. Well, what I love it for is, this is what I did over the weekend. And you have a photo and the child can hit the hotspots and it can tell the class or the teacher what they did over the weekend. Oh, for my iPad? Do you think it's going to work? I know. Of course, now I can't find any of the hotspots. Now it's not working for me at all. Maybe I lowered it too much. Okay. Well, I'm going to go to this. So another cool thing about this is it does have the body parts, and does it hurt, and all of that, because that is so hard for kids. And I will tell you that Henry was talking, even with all his issues, at 8 months, we were watching like the baby story or something on TV, and he said, "Ugh, baby squeezed." That's how much he talked. I mean, he is like this, and like he's so verbal, incredibly, incredibly verbal. At 22 months, we were flying to Minnesota to go to the Mayo Clinic to see a doctor there, and he said, "We fly high in the sky with the clouds. Daddy's driving, and he's going to meet us at the airport." So he was super verbal, and until he was about 10, he could not tell me what hurt. So he is like, I mean, he is so verbal, and he still, I mean, even this morning he called me. He had 2 seizures day before yesterday, then he was up all night throwing up. Obviously he had a stomach bug coming on. So he calls me this morning, and I'm like, "How are you feeling?" And he goes, "Still not great." I'm like, "Well, what's wrong?" "Well, I don't know." I'm like, "How do you not know?" So it's just a very hard concept for people to communicate. So I like on the ScenSpeak having that, the picture. Yeah. There's so much involved in it, in body awareness and then the communication is the least of it, probably.
He's talking though, but he has to stop.
Anyway.
It's very hard to realize. when somebody with excellent verbal skills, that there is that gap.
Right.
I mean, it's almost impossible to remember, oh, this may be happening and just not being
started. Right, right. And then, you know, Henry and probably a lot of y'all's kids have a really high pain tolerance. So that adds another thing. I mean, we probably five times when he was a little kid went to the doctor for something else, and he had strep throat. And he never complained, no sign of it. So that, you know, that adds to, well, yeah, maybe I have this gigantic bruise on my foot, but I'm not noticing that it hurts. So why would I say my foot hurts, you know? And then I'm going to show you inspiration maps because I just love this app. And it doesn't talk, so I think we're good. So inspiration maps is a graphic organizer app. And so you can put anything, you know, all your thoughts down in one of these mini templates. And I'm going to see if I have one. Oops. See if I have one. Oh, I don't think I have an example. Well, I'll show you one of these. So let's say we're looking at the English biography. So you can put in who you're researching and all of this information, and then put in your little facts about each one. So that's great, and you know, it's very helpful. But the cool thing about it is then I'm going to press this little, the three lines up there, and it's going to automatically turn it into an outline, which just like then makes it so easy to put on paper. Not wanting to, like...
I can remember being a kid not wanting to do an outline.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, Christmas, they tried to do this Christmas exact thing.
Yeah, but probably the...
Here, other schools, and it's just walk. Well, you know, it's like...
Yeah.
So how are you dealing with resistance?
Yeah. Well, so... Henry never used this because he's an excellent writer, so it's not his issue. Sam actually does use it because he hates to write.
Yeah.
And he doesn't have a problem with it. I think because he knows how much easier it's going to be to write the paper. And then the kids that I work with directly with are like, okay, yes, Miss Betsy, I'll do it. Because I'm not their mom. But I think it's more of that selling it to them. And I think it's easier to have someone else sell it than the mom or like the classroom teacher. Also, I mean, I find with Sam more than Henry, you know, he doesn't really think the classroom teacher, like, knows that much. You know, like, they kind of have that. It's almost like they're too, it's like you're a mom, you don't know anything either. Yeah. It's like they almost have too close a relationship.
Exactly. So someone, that's not like
a therapist or... Yeah. And I do, so my therapist, most of my therapists, I just hired a lady who's a little bit older, but most of my therapists are really young, and they are magical with like the teenagers because they, you know, they see them as a peer and they model, like with AAC, they'll model it with their iPad and yeah. So that's what I would suggest. Find somebody fun and not very close to the kid. So I love inspiration maps. I taught a class over at Xavier Educational Academy, which is a school over in Westview that's not really designed for kids with special needs, but they have a lot of kids with ADD and autism and all sorts of different things. And Henry went there. So I taught a class over there with 2 years, six junior boys who were in their junior year, teaching them how to use all of these things. And they were pretty receptive to it. They loved inspiration maps, loved it. In fact, this one kid, when I showed it to them the first time, he goes, can I go show this to somebody? And I'm like, who do you want to show it to? And he said, anybody who will look at it. I just want to show someone how cool it is. So they really loved it. And Sam loves it because, like I said, he doesn't want to write it all out. but it's less intimidating to write it out once he has that outline. And I will do it with him. Like, I'll prompt him, like, okay, what's the name of the person? Okay, type that there. When were they born? Okay, type that up there. So, but he loves it. And I love it. And I love all the different templates, but I mostly love that fact it changes it into an outline. Okay, so apps for organizational skills. I guess I'll talk through these others, sorry. FaceTime, which is already on your iPad and your iPhone, just amazing tool for using with people who have difficulty communicating or don't want to communicate. For a while, I was using FaceTime with one of my patients. Like, I was in his house on FaceTime with him because he just had such an easier time with eye contact and everything else with me when we're on FaceTime. It's great to talk to grandparents, great for kids who are nonverbal or minimally verbal to actually get to see their grandparents or other family members who are far away. I also use it a lot when I travel to talk to my kids because it's more like I'm there.
So are you saying that they will look at the face on FaceTime more than they'll look at you first?
Yes.
You like them to look away.
I know, I do too.
It is.
Abilipad is a word processing app that has a lot of customizations. You can customize all the keyboards on Abilipad. You can literally, if a kid's learning to type his name, you can just put the letters S-A-M and have them type it. You can make the keys big, you can make the keys little, you can do different shapes, you can put pictures on the keys. Totally customizable keyboard. It also has text-to-speech, so it can be used for augmentative communication, and it has word prediction and sentence prediction. So it's a great one. Explain Everything is a interactive whiteboard app. So what I love to use Explain Everything for, and Henry was good about doing this, if for a child who misses a lot of school or who needs to have something explained to them over and over and over again, these kind of apps are great because you can put a PDF within the app and write on it, or you can put a picture and write on it, or you can just write on the whiteboard and it records what you're writing and what you're saying. So it just plays it back as a movie. So like if a teacher's explaining a math problem and she's writing out the math problem on the app and she's saying, first we do this, then we do that, they're actually hearing it and seeing it. And then you can send it out through email. Yes, yeah. Yes, especially if you're past kind of the visual, because the next ones are visual schedules, but I think Explain Everything is a little like past just using a visual schedule. Like once they've mastered the visual schedule and they need something that more like maybe they'll just look at it and then do the steps, you know, or they can pause and hit play. And it's just great for kids who miss class because the teacher can do it and then send it to you. And then instead of having to make an appointment and all of that, it's just right there. And you know, usually those explanations are only a couple of minutes long, but it ends up being a 45 minute ordeal when you have to go through all of the rigmarole.
Do you have the teacher do it on
now? I have the teacher do it or have the parent do it, or the kid can do it themselves if they remember it. But I really like having the teacher do it. If the child's absent, they basically do the lesson on the app and then send it. Or if a child needs to have something explained, because then they can just keep playing it back instead of having to have the teacher say it over and over and over again. PicCollage is just a super fun app. I actually might show that if it's on here. It is. So it's a super fun app to make school projects. So my Sam hates to read and he hates to write, but he loves projects. So I have that going for me. But a lot of people don't like projects, so, oops. So you can choose different grids. I don't know why it's going to this. Oh, I want to skip that. They changed their layout a little bit. So you can choose a grid. So I'm going to choose that. You can also do a freestyle one. But what I love is down here it says web search. So you can go in here and type in something. So you can type in whatever, you know, you're working on and then choose some pictures and it automatically places them into the collage. You can also add text and you can write on top of it. So
this is always worrying about plagiarism and things like that. Can you just use any of the pictures that are on there? Do you have to
like for my course, my online course that I'm putting online and I'm charging for and all of that, I have to buy images. But for like a school project or whatever, it's just like printing it out or cutting it out of a magazine. You know, as long as you're not actually, right. I mean, I'm also careful like on my website, I don't use anything that's not either like the free open source or that I have bought as a stock photo. But anyway, this just makes, you know, instead of cutting and pasting the pictures, and typing it out and pasting that, this just makes it so much easier, yet they're still doing the same work. They've got the same product and they can hold it up and talk about it.
Yes,
it can be printed. It can also be emailed out. InClass is an app that was made for college students. It's a really great, digital agenda. So you can set it up for each class. It's a little complicated to set up, but once you get it set up, in each class basically has like a folder, and when you open that folder up and you start taking notes for that day, you can do typed notes, videos, audio recording, photos, and handwriting, all on the same page in the notebook, and so all of that is right there together, stored in one spot. You can also do like homework reminders, test reminders, all that kind of thing with it. First Sun Visual Schedule is the last one I'm going to show. I know I'm going over my time. I always, what? We're okay? Okay. I always go over. So this is First Sun Visual Schedule. This is just like the schedules that we've been making for years with our Velcro and our laminator. But you don't have to Velcro. I mean, you don't have to laminate and you don't have to use the Velcro. So they have a few pre-programmed in here and then you can make your own, put your own photos in there, all of that stuff. And you can check it off in different ways. And like this one, you can check off and then you can pull down for the next thing. Or you can do it this way. Or you can actually put it in the envelope.
Put on your socks.
Oh, it's not as loud as that other one was. Or you can move it over to show that you've completed it.
So we have a retail store, and often what we find is if someone's not right there all the time, saying, what's your next task on your list if you're idle? Drives us all crazy because you want them to be productive.
Right.
So we have Square. We can load this app on there and have all their tasks that they have
to on it. Yeah, and it's real easy to put everything on and move it around.
Okay, I know your speech path, so stop me if this is out of your area of expertise. I have a kid who's 10 and a half who can do all the tasks in the morning but has a heck of a time sequencing. And she has some visual skill issues that we're working with the OT on, so she's got us doing word search and crossword, you know, doing the ocular skills. Major distraction in the morning. Is it a visual schedule problem, or is it a sequencing? Do you have to be a good sequencer to use a visual schedule?
You don't have to be a good sequencer to use a visual schedule because it's already sequenced there for you. I would try it.
So you just keep redirecting them to the schedule and eventually you will get there?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I know I sound Where's my question? Seriously.
Yeah, yeah. I would use a visual schedule, and she might, you know, you might.
Be attractive.
What?
The computer might be more attractive.
Mm-hmm. And what I do with augmentative communication kids, and you could easily do this with anybody, is they wear their iPads, or like two of the kids I work with, their brother and sister who are nonverbal, they actually use iPhone pluses, and there's a thing called a chat bag, and it's like a soft case, carrying case, and so they can have that in the case like as a crossbody bag, and then they always have it with them, just flip it up.
But the other thing you said,
So, yeah, you can use your own photos. Yeah, she could. Yeah.
And then it's her, she's seeing herself. And then she's intrigued by what I'm doing.
But with a kid who has, also with a kid who has trouble sequencing, I would have it somehow attached to her. Okay. Otherwise, you're going to be like, you know, where's the phone? You know. Yeah, and they're also, for phones, they're lanyards. To me, that would be too much on my neck, but there are lanyards for phones, but I really like the chat bag, and they're made chat bag. Chat, C-H-A-T-B-A-G .net is her website, and it's a mom who makes them.
So your position is, if I'm using a visual schedule, my issue is sequencing.
Right,
okay.
Right, yeah.
So that can be a reason.
No. Reminders is an app that's already on your iPhone and iPad. And what I love about Reminders and what sets it apart from some of the other stuff is that you can set a reminder based on location. So if you drive away from home, it will say, do you have your lunch? So I love that. A new one that I just downloaded. Let me see. It's not even on here. It's called Orderly, also does that. And I'll show you Orderly real quick. It's not on there, but.
So, do I have my lunch? You can set it up for it to repeat Monday through Friday every 12 months of the year. So, like, yeah. For our guys here, that we have one that continually forgets his lunch. So,
yeah. So, here are my bridging apps. Tasks, and I just have one. I just have a survey email thing on here now, but I can put it on here, and then maybe I should. I wonder if I can do it. If I have anything I can check off, I don't think so, because I checked everything off last night. Oh, but you can see how they're crossed out. So those are things that I checked off, and this is also has the location reminder feature on it. So it has both this checklist kind of thing, and what you do is you can put it in either, I'm just trying to find one that I have. Okay. So you can put it in where you have different priority. So these are evaluations coming up, so they're prioritized by date. So some of them I put dates in, and then it'll automatically change the priority based on if the date's getting closer. So you could do that with schools. This one, the same thing. So like these submit for ASHA, that's not due until April 4th. So I went ahead and put it in with the due date of April 4th. And so when it gets closer, it'll move up to medium and then up to high when I have to do it. Yeah, yeah, and it has a location reminder function. So I just got that one. I saw it on a free app thing. I'm not sure if it's still free or not, but I downloaded it. I've looked at all of them, like all the reminder timeline, all of that stuff. So I like Orderly so far a lot. Notes is just a great app in your iPad or your iPhone because you can just take notes in there and leave them in there, and they're always there. And notes are searchable, so I use that all the time. And then ChoiceWorks and ChoiceWorks Calendar, I always like to mention because I know the developer, and she's a special ed teacher, and I really like her. And it's very similar to First Send Visual Schedule, but it looks a little different visually. I couldn't get it loaded. I was going to show y'all, but I couldn't get it loaded. But it's otherwise very similar to FIRST and Visual Schedule. The graphics are just a little different. But ChoiceWorks calendar is an actual, like a calendar where you can put on, like, we're going on vacation on Sunday, the whatever that the date is, 13th or whatever. And then when the child says, how many, you know, when are we going? Are we going today? It actually counts down visually and out loud so you can hear and see it counting down to the days till vacation. So it's a cool one, too.
Can you show us in class?
I can try. I thought it was loaded, but when I looked for it earlier, I couldn't. Oh, there it is. I don't know why it didn't pop up earlier. Because this one that I also tried to load. Okay, so here's in class. And you have like your, oops, I want to, I think if I go, oh, it says I have nothing on this day. So you can put them, you can see, it's like I said, it's kind of hard to set up. Like even for me, well, I don't use it personally. So every time I show it, I have to remember how to set it up. It's a little difficult to set up, but it does have alarms. You can set things for priority. And I'm gonna try
it.
You can color code it. So this is like the note feature. So see how in the notebook, I have all of these different things. I have this recorded note. I have, I added a PDF. These are photos that I added, and then you can handwrite. So it's just very nice to have all of that together. Like I said, the barrier is getting it set up. Like I think most kid, like even a typical college kid would probably need someone to walk them through it. I mean, I feel like I need someone to walk me through when I'm doing it. But once you get it set up, it's there. It's just a little, it's not quite intuitive to me, I guess, the setup of it. But I love this note-taking feature because you can have everything there. So my contact information is on the bottom of the handout. The Facebook page I'm using now is Communication Circles, but I do have Your App Lady also. So on my Your App Lady Facebook page, I do a lot of general apps. I do educational apps and apps for people with special needs, but also like general apps, like the app to help you find a clean bathroom and all sorts of different apps. So, and then Communication Circles is my business Facebook page where I also talk more about augmentative communication and speech therapy and other types of assistive technology. And then the Bridging Apps Facebook page, we put all our new reviews there as they go into the website. As well as, you know, what we're doing and what's going on in the world.
Any questions?
With the medical app, have you found, I love the medical app, it's like one of my favorite ones. I'm just so impressed with it. I can really utilize that with different chronic illnesses, different parents.
Oh, yeah.
I can just really see that. Was there any issues with, I know you have a password on your phone and such like that, but I guess,
there are no issues with the company. They are totally HIPAA compliant. Uh-huh. Kristen's husband is an attorney working in the medical space, so then they use it. That's my bar. She's like, well, what do they do for this? I'm like, I have no idea, Kristen. I'm like showing my kids' medical records, you know,
exactly,
to a group. Like, confidentiality is not one of my things, but she is very into it, and she is like, talk to them, and yeah.
It seems wonderful, because I know there was like jet drives you could carry around, like digitalize a lot of my son's stuff.
Right.
But then sometimes you might not always have the thing you need. You know what I mean?
Right. Right, and because this is organized and searchable. That's what I have the binders, but to find something in the binders is a nightmare.
And even on the jet drive, too, keeping up with it, this automatically keeps up with it as well.
Right.
And even if you do one for him, because you can add, like I can do Chris 1 and Chris 2.
Uh-huh.
Maybe some stuff on Chris 1, like say he was going to college or whatever, and you have access to that one.
Right.
Uploaded it, and Chris 2 can maybe, or vice versa, have more detail.
Right, right.
And it's
Who knows?